to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Chapter 3, the great book of Romans. We're going to pick it up here in a moment in about verse 26. Romans being the ABCs of the gospel. I mean, this is the foundation. And Paul is giving quite a Bible lecture here as we continue along. I want to go back to the fact that we're discussing law. And we're discussing atonement. That means forgiveness from Almighty God. In the closing verse in the last lecture, in verse 25, it's stated very clearly there, whom God hath sent forth to be a propitiation, that is to say, through faith in his blood, to declare the righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God. God's got a lot of patience. But there's something I want you to know about that verse. Propitiation, that's the mercy seat. It's the same word as the mercy seat, basically. Which means what? God's mercy. In other words, in times past, he set that mercy seat, even in the first earth age, it was there. Why? Because that's where Satan was. He was one of the cherubims on each end of it that protected the mercy seat. He wanted to take over that mercy seat. So this is why he said, one that really wants to clearly search, you go back to the origin. That means the beginning. So you have to go back to the first earth age to understand God knows his children pretty good. And certainly that atonement, which is that mercy seat, the seat of Christ, the fact that that office was put in existence before it ever actually became into being. Even with the appearance of Melchizedek, the office came into being before the birth of the only begotten. Our Father's way ahead of us, but you need to catch up occasionally. You need to understand, because he sent this one that was planned long ago, that through his blood, if you believe, you must remember back where it said, this is for those that believe. That's what separates. Because you've got some that would claim to believe, but then if you question them just a little bit, you see there's so much doubt there, they're not really truly believers. So having said that and realizing what he's talking about here, he continues then with the fact that you know, that both for Israel and for Gentiles, that mercy seat is there, that propitiation for sins in his blood on that cross is so very ever meaningful. So let's pick it up with the first verse then of this chapter 3 to complete it, verse 26, and with that word of wisdom from our Father, and it reads, concerning that atonement, to declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, how good he is, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. A lot of people say, well, why doesn't it work for me? You don't believe. You can't play games with God. You cannot con God. You can't lie to him. He reads your mind. He knows what you're thinking. So you either believe or you don't. And he is righteous, he's faithful, and he is timely. And it is his office to forgive if you truly ask and if you repent. Again, the ABCs of the good news. Verse 27, where is boasting then? You want to claim you're an Israelite and something special? You want to claim you're one of God's elect and something special? You want to boast about it? Excluded. By what law? Question. Of works? Nay, no way. But by the law of faith. That's what is that faith then? Believing on Jesus Christ, that he was the only begotten. And through him, you have that mercy seat. You can approach it. As a matter of fact, he ripped the veil down where you can approach it at any time. You don't have to be some preacher or high priest to walk in. He ripped that veil from top to bottom, right into where the mercy seat is, and said, come on in. But you got to believe, or you better not go in. Verse 28. Therefore, we conclude, or this is the matter of the whole thing. We conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Now, here's where a lot of people really go wrong. Is, well, you don't need the law anymore. The law is done away with. And the word without here in the Greek language is charis. It means apart or separate from the law. It means you can go in. It doesn't say the law is bad. It said you can go in apart from the law. Why? Because of the mercy seat. Because of the propitiation of your sins through Christ, his blood on the cross. If what? If you believe. So don't ever say that the law is, do your homework. Again, I will say the word without here is charis in the Greek tongue. And it means apart from or separate from the law. It has nothing to do with doing away with the law or condemning the law. The law is good. It's man that's bad. Verse 29. Is he the God of the Jews, or that's to say the Israelites only? Question. Is he not also of the Gentiles? Question. Yes. Of the Gentiles also. He created all of his children. I don't care what race, color, or creed, God created your very being. And when he created, on the last verse of chapter 1, the great book of Genesis, he looked and it was good. Paul, this particular teacher's mission, this apostle, his mission is a threefold mission to Israel, to the Gentiles, which is to say the other races, as well as the kings and queens of the ethnos. God is the God of all. There's only one God. He's the God of all. That's not a big step for a stepper. Verse 30. Seeing it is one God, which shall justify the circumcision by faith and the uncircumcision through faith. In other words, he will justify an Israelite by faith, and he will justify a Gentile because and through his faith. The same Father, and the same forgiver of sins, the same propitiation, the same mercy seat, the same atonement for whomsoever will believe. Verse 31. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yea, we establish the law. It's only with faith in Christ can you even come close to fulfilling the law. And that is a fact. A believer in Christ attempts, at least does a pretty good job of following that law. But your salvation comes apart from the law. Because if the law could save you, then Christ died in vain on the cross. But God knew that he knows his children pretty well. He knows we fall short. Therefore, he sent this Savior. He sent that office. He himself came in that office, Emmanuel, God with us, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Whereby, as long as you believe, then charis, apart from the law, you reach that mercy seat, and he reaches out to you, and he takes you, and he holds you, he forgives you, because he loves you. He loves you enough that he died on that cross for you. And so don't ever say the law is bad. It's God's law. Jesus would say in Matthew, I changed not one jot, not one iota of the law. I came to fulfill it, and he fulfill it, he does. Chapter 4, verse 1. Well, what shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? What can we say about old Abraham? I mean, first of all, why was he called Abraham? He was Abram before, and God changed his name to Abraham. What does Abraham mean? Father of many nations. He'd be to be a blessing to all people, because through him would come this one. Verse 2. For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. He might glory before men, but he couldn't glory before God, because God gave him everything. God gave him the promises. God promised, it was God that promised him, I'm going to take you from the land of Ur. You're going to go out here. You're going to be as numerous as the stars of your children. He's 100 years old. He's too old to have children. But God promised. And Abraham believed. And he accounted that as justified. God did. Verse 3. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God. He didn't doubt. And it was counted unto him for righteousness. He was not guilty by faith. Now, that's what faith will do for you. And you want to know how important it is. You show me somebody without faith, and I'll show you somebody that's not a winner. Now, to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. In other words, if you go out here and work at something on your job by the end of the week, it's a debt owed you. You can count on it. It's coming. Verse 5, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. In other words, if you believe in Christ, if you reach out to him and you ask for help, in a sinning world, if you'll reach out and touch him, he will reach down and touch you, because that's his obligation. That's his duty. He died to put that office there. And that office, even in the first earth age, that mercy seat was there. And was there all the time. Verse 6. Even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. Where did David say that? What is he talking about? Well, Paul was a great scholar of God's word, and he's quoting Psalms 32. You're going to have it. We're going to cover it. Psalms 32, that's what he's quoting, and you need to hear all of it to really understand the promises of God and that seat that sits there. So go with me to chapter 32 of the great book of Psalms. In verse 1, listen to it. Blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Covered by what? The mercy seat. Verse 2, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. When he forgives one, you're blessed. Well, I've always wanted to be blessed. It's this simple. But you can't play a church. You can't play. You have to mean it. Verse 3, when I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. When I kept silence, as it was, and the Song of Wisdom gives instructions, verse 4, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. Selah. Selah means stop the music, pause a moment. We're going to connect this trouble that we're just talking about with the trouble of conviction into confession. This is how you do it, okay? You want to come to repentance? There's got to be confession. And that's why this Selah is here. It means pause, stop the music. Think about it, meditate, just like a cow chooser could. That's what the word, the meditation comes from, that very word, is to pause and think about it, re-chew it, think it over, mull it over, and go again. So here comes the confession, verse 5. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and iniquity have I not hid. I didn't try to hide it from you, God. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Stop the music again. Stop and think after that confession to God, the divine forgiveness here. Now, what follows that? What do you do next? Prayer and praise after forgiveness. Meditate on it. Chew it again. And then let's go on with prayer and praise. 6. For this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely in the floods of great waters they shall not come nigh unto him. Verse 7. Thou art my hiding place. You protect me. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. He always looks over. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. Selah, stop the music, the prayer and praise. Let's connect that now with what? What always God gives you, further instruction. Listen carefully. 8, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. Father, if you're sincere with God, he will instruct you. Wisdom comes from him. His word is your letter of instruction. Verse 9, be ye not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with a bit and bridle, lest they come near unto thee. I have to say that there are many mules and horses that are smarter than men, but it is true, to communicate with them, you do need a bridle. Then they can heed to it quite well, because they're intelligent. Verse 10, many sorrows shall be to the wicked. They can't help it. They bring it on themselves. But he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy, that's from the mercy seat, shall compass him about. It's all around you. Verse 11, be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. That is to say, the people that truly understand that mercy seat, the price that was paid there, and the fact that it was paid for you. When you believe that he comes to you, and that he provides that for you. And again, I want to remind you, when you're a student that wants to go back to the origin, which that's what seeking, as it was in the prior chapter, meant in verse 11 of that chapter, the word meant go back to the origin. It means into the first earth age. The mercy seat was already there. Why? Because God knew we would need it. He provided it for us. He provided it for you. Now, returning to chapter 4 of the great book of Romans, let's pick it back up again in verse 7. With those beautiful thoughts in mind, and verse 7 reads, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Covered by what? The blood of Christ. That's why it's so important to you, beloved, that you love him and that you appreciate him. He is the Prince of Peace, and if you want peace in your life, if you want peace in your mind, if you want to find peace of mind, that's where you find it. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Well, now, what is sin again? Explain sin to me. Well, sin is to transgress the law. That's why the law is so very important. Well, document that for me. Well, you'll find it in the little first epistle of John. And it is written there that sin is the transgression of the law. If any time you transgress the law, you have sinned. But to be imputed, meaning to put it on the mercy seat, it can be forgiven when expressed. Verse 9, cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision? Is it only for Israel? only or upon the uncircumcised also. For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. Well, how can they say that? Well, it's really quite simple. Abraham, who was Abram, his wife's name being changed to Sarah from Sarai, and Abram being changed to Abraham by Almighty God. Sarah was 90 years old, too old for childhood to bear children, and Abraham 90, but it was God's promise. Now, you might say, well, how could then the circumcision be effective in this? It isn't. Well, how can you document that? It would be 14 years later before Abraham would be circumcised. I want to say that again so you don't forget it. Because when this promise was given, Abraham was not circumcised. So you cannot say it was for the circumcision only. God wants you to know that point, that forgiveness is for whomsoever will. Because Abraham, you cannot claim it was for Israel only, because he was not circumcised until 14 years later, after the promise was given. Then was he circumcised. So it is the faith and your belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father and the gift he gives us. That is the ABCs of the gospel, the good news, that it was planned long ago, that your Father loves you. And he makes this path for you so easy if you will listen, if you will not be stubborn and have to have a bit put in your mouth to turn you this or that, if you just fall in line and accept his love and understanding and receive his forgiveness. He's long-suffering, whereby you have that obligation and that opportunity. How blessed it is. So the answer is really very simple. God made it very plain for you. No. Circumcision doesn't really have anything to do with forgiveness, because Abraham was not circumcised until 14 years later after this promise. Verse 10, how was it then reckoned? How could that be? When he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision, not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. How could it be? Because he wasn't even circumcised, so that has nothing to do with it. In fact, now, by Christ's death on the cross, circumcision is no longer of the flesh, and bloodletting, or you commit sacrilege if you do it for a spiritual reason, because circumcision is of the heart and it applies to both man and woman. It is to love him. Verse 11. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal. It was first by faith, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed or made available, atonement unto them also, to everyone. You know, God doesn't leave anyone out that believes. I don't care who you are. So there's no boasting done by Israel, though this does not lift one iota of the duties and prophecies that God's election of Israel are supposed to perform. It doesn't make you any better than anyone else. It makes you a servant of the living God and a servant of all. This is why Jesus said, who's the highest in the kingdom? He said, you're the highest, you become the servant of all. He was. And so it was. Verse 12, to continue. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. That same faith brought righteousness and is considered righteousness, and so it should be. 13. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law. You understand? it was not through the law, but through the righteousness of faith, of the seed in Christ, of Christ, for Christ, by Christ, that knowing that God's promise always comes through. You know, anytime I read these verses, I can't help but think of Isaiah chapter 43, verse 26, where God says, hey, remind me of my promises. Do you think God has forgotten them? No, he has not. He remembers every promise. But he wants to know if you've read them. He wants to know if you know them. He wants to know if you've read his letter. He said, remind me of them. Let's talk about it so I can justify you. That means so I can enter you and make things right with you. In other words, I'm willing to help you, but you need to come on here a little bit. Who do you think I am? You know by my promises. And his promise was, not by law, but because of the love that he had from that mercy seat, the propitiator of all sin, that would believe upon him. Verse 14. For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect. If it's only that way, then certainly the promise of all people, it would be limited. You can't limit God. It would be void because he said all people. That's what Abraham means in the Hebrew tongue, the father of all nations. It couldn't be for Israel only, the circumcision so-called, and be for the whole world. 15, because the law worketh wrath. For where no law is, there is no transgression. Law, this is why you will hear me say sometimes, where there is no law, there is no sin, because that's what it means. If there's not a law against it, it's not a sin. And this is why many times when people are ignorant of the law, God does not give them a convicting sin, a correction, a thump on the gourd, an education. Verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace. That's to say the free gift. That's what grace is. Okay. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not part, all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, Israel, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Abraham, in the Hebrew tongue, meaning the father of all nations. That was the promise of God. And when faith comes, that faith must spread to all whomsoever will believe. Is it a new thing? Did it just happen at the cross? Well, that fulfilled it, but it happened even in the first earth age when the mercy seat, that seat of propitiation, came into being. Our Father had that law in effect. For those that are scholarly enough to know it, then it would be a sin to teach anything other than that. Verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. That's what his name means. Before him whom he believed, even God, quicken the dead, he brings them alive eternally, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. In other words, he, the creator of all, the father of every event, the father of all things. And how precious. Well, what is he quoting here? Genesis 17:5. And have you ever read it? Genesis 17:5? Maybe you should. Verse 18, who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And Abraham did believe. You know, Sarah laughed. I mean, here she's 90 years old. Found out she was with child and would have children. She laughed, and that's why Isaac, the child thereof, is called Laughter, because his mama laughed when she knew he was in her womb at 90 years old. And so it was that he would be called that. And through, well, then you mean that all, then they became as numerous as, because of Christ who would come through that seed. The seed is called in Christ. And so it is that Father Abraham in Christ would be the Savior, propitiation for all peoples who would believe and who would have the faith in him to bring those things to pass. Next verse, please, verse 8:19. And being not weak in faith, and certainly he was not, he considered not his own body, now dead, 100 years old. He was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. She was 90. When God truly tells you something, do you have the faith to believe? You see, Abraham did. Though it would seem, here we have two things. With Sarah, she was way too old. With Mary, she was way too young. Okay. But when God speaks, that's it. That's the way it is. And so it was that this seed would come forth, this forgiver of sins for those who would believe upon him, but never, ever, ever forget what it cost him. Well, I thought it was free. I thought salvation was free. Christ paid an awesome sin price on the cross, his life, his blood, so that you could have that propitiation, so that it could be. And forever, blood sacrifices were wiped clean from off the face of the earth, as it's written in Hebrews chapter 10, that God himself made it possible that we had that forgiveness, and you do today, when you truly believe and when you truly have the faith and you love him enough to come to him and go through the steps that we went through in Psalms 32. Confession and praise, and then seek instruction. He is so good to his children, and if he's good to you, you know he has accepted you as a child. You are anyway, whether you like it or not. But a blessed child is a lot better off than one that isn't. All right, bless your hearts. So listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It is getting late in the game. You need to know what the mark of the beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. There is no need for you to be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject, the mark of the beast. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. We don't even ask for the shipping and handling. It is free as well. All you need to do is call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of the mark of the beast. You may also request your free CD by mailing your request to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
And there we are back again. Let's have the 800 number, please. 1-800-643-4645. That number is good from Puerto Rico throughout the U.S., Alaska, Hawaii, all over Canada. If the Spirit moves and you have a question, share it. Once you do that, please never ask a question about a particular reverend or denomination. We're not going to judge people. We don't have to. God does. And you have the right for spiritual discernment, and that simply allows you to know truth from fiction. That is to say, believe truth and put aside fiction and let it go by the wayside. Stick to God's word. That is truth. Now, those of you that listen by shortwave around the world, it's always a pleasure hearing from you, and your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. It's always a pleasure. Now, got a prayer request. You don't need the number or the address. Why? God knows what you're thinking. He loves you. He put all these things in motion where you would have the privilege of only repentance. having forgiveness and receive eternal life. What a Father we have. He cares. So return that love. That's what he wants from you. Father, around the globe we come. We ask that you lead, guide, direct, Father. Touch in Yeshua's precious name. Thank you, Father. Amen. Okay, Ethel from Michigan. How do I pray for someone that has done me wrong? Well, pray that they get everything they got coming to them. Okay? And at the same time, you know, you have set a good example. Let that example fall off on them. Pray that Father's will be done. God is a God of vengeance. If somebody picks on one of God's elect, they're going to get what for? You can count on it. That's why you don't have to judge people. God doesn't need your help in that. But God bless you. Author from South Carolina. How were we created in the first earth age? How did God tell us? Did God tell us to replenish heaven? No, he did. There was no birth in heaven in the first earth age. God created all beings. There was no replenishing to it. That happened in this earth age. And as you read in Genesis chapter 6, verse 3, it grieved God that he had made man flesh also. But, Father created us in the first earth age, and you can read of it. There's just a little peek that you get in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 31. That wisdom is speaking in that chapter. Do you have wisdom? Wisdom is a precious thing. But wisdom was with God when he created all things. Wisdom was with him when he created the sons of God. Because of that verse and other places is why I tell you, I feel all souls are the same age. Because the sons of men were all created at the same time. There's no gender in that. It's everyone. So, and you read that in Proverbs 8:31. Another place where God's children in the first earth age are mentioned as all as one group is in the great book of Job in chapter 40, 38 through 40. William from Arkansas, are you saying that you can be saved and can still go to hell? What do you think? You know, If you are saved and then all of a sudden you turn around because of ignorance, you haven't studied God's word, you worship Satan as the Antichrist, you think you're not going to hell? Do you think in the last lecture, did it not say that propitiation was for sins past, not future, past? So naturally, who does the saving? Christ does. Christ's salvation is always there. But after you sin, you have got to repent, because if you don't, you're going to answer for it. And if you fall far enough away from that salvation and sin, you're going to hell. Christ didn't fail, and don't you ever dare accuse him of it. It's man that fails. These religionists that would teach you once you're saved, you can do whatever you want to, any sin, you're saved, you're hell bound, and they're going before you do because they're responsible. They're false teachers. Ruby from Arkansas. I would like to know what will happen to the Book of Light after the white throne judgment is set up. What, have you ever read Mark chapter 13? Times will change. The first earth age changed to this earth age, and this earth age is going to change to the third earth age. This first heaven age was changed to this earth heaven age, and the third heaven age is going to change again. But there's one thing that will never change. It's the word of God. So it will always be the same. It will never change. It will always be with us. It's our Father's word and his way. Dean from North Carolina. Question, who was Mary's mother and father? Mary's father, as you would read in, don't read in Matthew chapter 1, that's Joseph's folks, and Joseph's folks have nothing to do with Mary or Christ, other than Joseph was her husband. and Joseph naturally was not the father of Christ. So Mary's mother and father were, as you find in the great book of Luke, chapter 3, Heli was Mary's father, and he was of the tribe of Judah. Then you read in Luke 1 about Elizabeth. But what has Elizabeth got to do with Mary? A lot. Because Elizabeth was married, she was of the daughters of Aaron, meaning she was a full-blood Levite. And she was married to Zacharias, a Levite priest, which that had to be. They were both Levites, of the tribe of Levi. But then the day Mary conceived, she rushed to Elizabeth's house because Elizabeth was her cousin. Now, if Elizabeth, being a full-blood Levite, is Mary's cousin, how did that come to be? What makes one a cousin? It means you have parents, brother, or sister in common. Meaning, we know the father was of Judah, so Mary's mother was a Levite, a full-blood Levite. She was a sister to Elizabeth's mother. Therefore, Elizabeth being a Levite, then this means Mary was half Levite and half of Judah, and Almighty God was the father of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, the Lord Jesus Christ, forever after the order of Melchizedek, Melchah, king, Zedek of the just, of righteousness, then he forever is the king of peace and king of kings and Lord of lords. Why? Because he is of the Levitical priesthood, and he is of Judah the king line, making him king of kings and Lord of lords. God's word is always perfect if you just take a moment to go through it to understand it. So to answer your question in a simple way, Mary's mother was a Levite and Mary's father was of Judah. Jane from Alabama, question. I would like to know which Bible Pastor Arnold recommends that we use. Thank you very much and God bless you. A standard King James, not an NIV. That's been changed by the Kenites. You can, they won't claim it, but they did. There are many things have been changed that are harmful in it to knowledge, wisdom. But a standard King James, I recommend for the deeper student or one that really wants to be serious about studying God's Word, the Companion Bible in which we carry here at this chapel. Nancy from Georgia, question, is it a sin for a Christian to be cremated? And the answer, you know, I receive this a lot, and it's because of hard times. Funerals are expensive. They can be. Cremation, because why? When we're through with these flesh bodies, you're through with it. It's not going to resurrect. You already have resurrected by God's word. You have two bodies. 1 Corinthians 15 makes that very clear. And this flesh body is going back to dirt, but your beautiful spiritual body, which is from the first earth age even, because it never ages, it never gets sick, it never gets old, it never gets wrinkled, it instantly returns to the Father that gave it. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 6 and 7. So naturally, it doesn't matter that you are cremated and you save the expense of some expensive going away formula for the dead, because the dead are already gone. This is why, you know, I'll just spend just a second on this. A lot of people say, well, you don't understand, brother. There's a resurrection. There's a trumpet sounding and we're flying away. Well, no, you're not. People are misleading you if you believe that. Well, you've never read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 in more than one language. I have. Do you know what it truly says? If you go back to the subject and the object, in verse 13 and 14, it said, if you believe Jesus rose from the dead, then you better believe all those that are dead or asleep in him have risen also. They don't wait till a trump. They're already gone. God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. They live. They're with him. They're already there. And don't you let some preacher trick you up on that. Read it for yourself. A child can understand it. And then it says at the seventh trump, but don't forget the sixth when the Antichrist comes. We've got work to do then. But at the last trump, the furthest one out, then Christ returns and we all are changed into spiritual bodies. So we all get that spiritual body at that time. Teresa from Texas, question. My daughter would like to know why sheep were an abomination to the Egyptians. Because that's their religion. And sheep, a lamb is the easiest to digest. It's some of the best food for a meat eater. I know there is a difference between lamb and mutton. Mutton is an older sheep. Okay. So you got to know which. But anyway, the Egyptians, there was an Upper Egypt and a Lower Egypt. This is why that the Upper Egypt, it was a sin to have sheep. But the Lower Egypt was called the Shepherd Kings. And those Shepherd Kings were none other than the Israelites that had been driven or were away from Israel itself. But it was against their religion. Wayne from Arizona, I am a new student. Can you explain to who the elect are? Well, to open your Bible to the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 4, where God says, I chose you before the foundations of this earth age. Then what does that mean? Well, it means exactly what it says. You know, if God makes a statement, you don't need a translator to do it for you. It's when you get in trouble is when God makes an absolute statement through one of his apostles. You start trying to translate it yourself and you can get in trouble. But it means exactly what it says. And the word in the Greek, the noun, is even katabo, which means I chose you before Satan's overthrow. And that overthrow we read of in Ezekiel chapter 28, of course. But that's why they are God's elect, because they weren't deceived by Satan in the first earth age, and they're not about to be deceived by him in this earth age. They're going to make that stand against him, as it's written in Mark chapter 13. They're not going to premeditate what they will say when they're delivered up before him when he comes at the sixth trump, but will allow the Holy Spirit to speak through them. Brooke from Alabama, question, is the Queen of England in the lineage of King David? The stone was carried, Jacob's pillar was carried by those people, the 10 tribes that went north over the Caucasus Mountains. What is the first obligation of a queen or king? The sex has, king or queen has nothing to do with it, it's the office. What is the first obligation? It's protector of the faith of Israel. You want me to say that again? Semper Fidelis of Israel, which is to say the protector of the faith of Israel, to see that nobody changes it. And as it is written, that stone would be overturned, overturned, and overturned. The fourth overturn, Christ would return and take it for himself. So, yes, there's a little something there that if one wants to make a study into, it's a beautiful thing. It is people that make light of that will live to regret it before the end of time. Donna from Arkansas, Pastor Murray, Ezekiel 44:25 says, we can go help a father, mother, son, daughter, brother, or for a sister that has not had a husband. They may defile themselves. Why can we only help our sister that hath no husband? It means because once she's married, she becomes his responsibilities, not yours, okay? Does it mean if they were married, we can not help them? Well, if her husband was not around, you could. But it falls under the fact that she is, when two marry, they become one flesh. So she's her husband's responsibility there, okay? That's kinsman redeemer. God honors that, and it's quite important to him. Ron from Ohio, can you please explain John 14? John 14 is a pretty long chapter. It says in John 14 that in my Father's house there are many mansions. And a person that does not understand the languages cannot understand what that means. They picture some big, luxurious place, and that's not what it means at all. It says, in my Father's house are many resting places. And naturally, mano and mane in the Greek tongue means where the Father and the Son are, you're going to have that resting place because He is rest. Brings you peace of mind. Because it's talking about the Comforter coming, which is the Holy Spirit. And wherever the Father and the Son are, there's the Holy Spirit, because it's the Spirit of God. And it means if you really want to find rest, you don't have to wait till heaven to receive it. You can receive it today by accepting Him, by looking at His Word, and know that in Him we have that place of rest. He is our rest. He is our Sabbath. And Sabbath means resting place. Juanita from, don't know where Juanita's from. Thank you for your comment on the Feast of Trumpets. Okay, a question, do you know where the Ark of the Covenant is? Read chapter 11, the great book of Revelation, the last two verses. It's in heaven. God took it back, okay? And also, I'd love to hear more about the stone with Paleo-Hebrew of the Cherokees. Did you know those Indians knew Yahweh's name? Sure, the Cherokee tribe worship Yahweh and the Holy Spirit, they do. I had the privilege of being able to translate that stone myself. I remember when I was 15 years old that there was a great article came out about that stone, and I marveled at it, but little did I know that many years later I would be the one who would truly be able to translate it using the Masoretic text that is inscribed therein, where it's out of Loudoun County, Tennessee, and on the stone, which is now in the Smithsonian Institute, it states very clearly that it has a resh pointed the wrong way. That's a resh is an R in the Hebrew tongue, and it has A-R-A, which means the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, is the voice, which is the poker that draws these firebrands back to Him, meaning those priests that were buried there. Okay, that's all it says. It's complete. It's a perfect string. Sabra, there are many people that could translate that, but why don't they? That's a good question. I'm not saying I'm something special, that I have seen things other people don't. Anybody that can read Paleo-Hebrew can make that translation. With one exclusion, they must know the Masoretic text, the footnotes. Sabra from Oklahoma. I am unable to locate a verse in the Old Testament regarding the six-day creation that grew their wheat in the sea. Please help. Thank you for... Well, it's when I teach the first chapter of the great book of Genesis. You will read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 20. It will say, I've created the creature, the moving creature of the water, and that has life. And that word life in the manuscripts is nephesh, which means soul. In other words, I created a living soul that lives from the water. Therefore, I feel we know a people that live by the water. They grow their wheat from the water, rice, and so it is. It's just simply a supplement. You take it or leave it like it is. Dorothy from Ohio. Pastor Murray, I would like to know if you could give me some background on where Cain's wife came from. Thank you. From the six-day creation. This is why it leaves many Bible students hanging way out in the dark. Cain went to the land of Nod and took a wife. Well, how did she get there? How did the land of Nod get there? Six-day creation is that simple. And it is not a difficult thing. Those of you that truly want to learn, in my teaching, the first six chapters of the great book of Genesis, I teach you how to read the Hebrew to define the six-day creation, where you can better understand. It is, if you are a sincere student, then it's well worth your time to order the video of the first six chapters of Genesis, and I will teach you in that how to read the Hebrew manuscripts themselves, for that's where it is, that the six-day man was created, and then on the eighth day he created Eth Ha'adam, which is the man through which Christ would come. Eddie from Canada, I know that you said that once we have sinned and repented, we are not to ask God again for the same sin. I was wondering if you mean that if we do it again, that God doesn't want to hear it again. But I am not sure exactly what that means. Now I know that Jesus said, no. Naturally, if you do it again, you better mention it again. You better repent of it again, okay? That's because you sinned again. You always have to repent. 7 times 90, 490 times, if necessary. I'm out of time. Yeah, I love you all because you enjoy studying God's word most of all. God loves you for it. Hey, mix his day when you study his letter that he sent to you. You make his day, boy, is he going to make yours. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we have helped you, you help us keep coming to you. Once you do that, you bless God. He will always bless you. Most important, though, listen to me. Listen good. You stay in his word every day. And his word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus, Yeshua, is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast audio tape, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a tape catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at this same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you. The book of Peter, here we have two books, 1st and 2nd Peter, that are absolutely fascinating. That great old fisherman telling us, leading us, directing us, guiding us, going into the depth, if you would, in that second book, into the three earth ages, giving the most accurate recorded account of the events that transpire and document that there are three earth ages, that there was one before this one, and one to come. Peter, the great fisherman, which in his gentleness and his kindness brings us two books, the books of Peter, that lead, guide, direct, even in your daily life, that teach and show you how to be happy, how to find that peace of mind, and to know yourself. The books of Peter, I know you're going to enjoy them. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. We're going to redo a soundtrack, the soundtrack on the Song of Moses. This is a very important topic. You know, I will use the old cliche, going to heaven, on our way to heaven. Well, these are the words, as we'll find, that those that overcame in the final generation, the false Messiah, his way